Yeah, good morning all. We'll start our discussion. So we had started with classification. So to continue with, so what is classification is basically whenever you want to find out, there is a set of say examples or data sets, and you need to build a structure from it in order to decide something. That is, you have a set of rules based upon which you have to decide what you can do. That is, it is a process of finding interesting pattern from whatever you are decided. So based upon that, even if a data set is given, what is our intention is we are trying to group them based upon its attribute. So in classification, there are many techniques, like you have decision tree, you have Bayesian classification. So what is the underlying principle of classification is, classification is basically used to check the unseen cases from the seen cases. So based upon the historic data, whatever you have learned, using that as a rule, you will try to decide what can be done for the next data set. So what we have to do is, in classification, there are two important tasks. That is, coming up with training set and test set. Usually your training and test set will be in the percentage 70-30 or 80-20. So for example, in your data set, if you have say 100 samples or 100 tuples, so each of the sample in your data set is called as tuples. So if you have say 100 tuples, 80% or 70% of your data set will be used for training, remaining 20% or 30% will be used for testing. So it is classified or grouped based upon 7:3 or 8:2 rule. So the thumb rule is 7:3. That is, 70% of your available data set is divided into training set, whereas 30% of data set will be used for test data set. So what are we doing is, using the training set, we will come up with a model. For example, if I'm trying to grade based upon the marks score, depending upon the number of students, what I'll do is, first I will divide 70% of them. For example, the marks scored in DMDW. In that case, 70% of students' marks will be used and a model will be created. So based upon this, now if I give a new tuple or new sample of say 30%, I should be able to derive what is the grade scored by say student X, depending upon whatever model I have created. So this is what is classification. So it is used to derive the important or the interesting pattern out of what is the important thing in the data set or the data classes. So basically your classification concentrate on predicting the value of decision class from unknown classes. So you have a set of unknown classes. From the unknown classes, you will try to build a model. Once you have built a model, you will use a particular value or say tuple which you have not used for training. The new sample is taken or a new tuple is taken and it is applied to the model that you have created, and that model should be able to find out for which particular class your tuple or sample belongs to. To know more about this, so the formal definition, we'll see through the formal definition. So given a collection of records, that is training set, each record will consist of attribute and class. See, what is this class? It is a label. Whenever you have a class label associated with your data set, you say it is supervised learning technique where you clearly know which class your attributes belongs to. Whereas clustering is one more technique, your data mining technique, where you will not know the class label. So whenever you know the class label or the class to which your set of attributes belongs to, you will come to know, okay, I can classify this. So usually your classification will be a binary or a multi-valued attribute. What do you mean by binary classification? Whenever your output is in terms of binary, that is either yes or no or true or false, if your class label is only a binary attribute, that is it is having only two values like yes, no or true, false, then you can say that type of classification is binary attributed. Similarly, you can have multi-valued attribute also. So the multi-valued attribute can range up to say n attributes. Anything which is more than 3 to n attributes can be classified as multi-valued attribute. So usually your classification is a binary attribute. That is, in your class you will be having two labels, that is either yes or no or true or false. So once we have this training set or the record with attribute and class, what we will do is we will apply the classification rule. So according to the classification rule, it can be 7:3 or 70% of your data set is used as training set. So once you have decided what is your training set, you will come up with a model. So model can be got through learning through those examples that you are using for a training set. So you have to create a model in such a way that it should be able to learn the attribute and derive some relationship between the attributes in terms of a function. So what are you trying to do? From the training set, you are trying to get some correlation or what you can say, instead of correlation, it can be also said some relationship between the attributes are derived. Once you get the relationship between the attributes, you can call it as a model in a generalized sense. So now we have training set and model. So this 30% which was not used for your training of your model is called as test set. So this test sets are previously not seen or previously it is not taken into existence for training that particular model. So this previously unseen records can be used as test set. So what is test set? Test set is used to determine the accuracy of the model. Usually the given data is divided into training set and test set, whereas your training set will be used to build the model, whereas test set is used to validate it, or it is used to find the accuracy of the model. See, this is the important slide. This is the formal definition of classification. So whenever a question is asked on classification, you should know that you will be applying classification for a data set which has a class label. So classification is a supervised technique. Why supervised? Because you clearly know to which class your attribute belongs to. Once a data set is given, you will divide it into training set and test set. Usually 70% of your data set will be your training set and 30% will be used for your test set. So once I have my training set, what I'll do is I will try to relate the attributes in your training set as, and it has to be expressed as some function. So once you are able to do that, it is called as a model. So once you derive model from your training set, your test set is a new set of tuples or new set of samples which are not used to create the model. So by taking this test set, what I'll do is I will try to validate the model and find the accuracy of model. Because we know the class label well in advance, now this unseen set will be applied to the model and you will check whether you have got the same class label as expected. So this is the overall explanation of classification. Goal, what is the goal? Goal is you will take the test set and try to validate the model which you have derived from your training set. So classification problem can be defined as, if you have a database or a data set D with tuples say T1 to TN, check whether you have followed. So given this particular data sets, what you are trying to do is, you are trying to find a mapping function. So what is your mapping function? So you have a data set or database with tuples say T1 to TN, and you also have a set of classes C which define to which class each tuple belongs to. So now what is your work is, you have to find out mapping between D and C. So classification problem is defined as the process of finding an mapping function where each attribute or tuple of D maps to each attribute of C. So that what you are trying to do here, each tuple Ti should be assigned to one of the classes from the subset C. So how we can do this? We can actually divide this D into equivalent classes. So what do you mean by equivalence classes? So for example, if I have say 100 tuples, so the equivalence classes will be 10 subclasses or 10 equivalence classes of 10 tuples each. So that is your equivalence classes. So equivalence classes is, you will divide the whole data set into equal number of groups where each group will have same number of tuples. So once you have come up with a classification technique, it can be used to predict whether the model is able to derive your classification results or not. So this we have seen. So there are many classification examples. So this is what we discussed. So based upon the mark score, we are trying to grade based upon the mark score. So these are the equivalence classes. In this case, the equivalence classes is done based upon the mark score. So if mark score by student X is say greater than or equal to 90, then you can grade A. If it is between the range 80 to 90, it is treated as grade B. If it is in the range 70 to 80, it is grade C. If it is between 60 to 70, it is grade T. If it is less than say 50, the mark score is less than 50, then you can grade it as F. So what you are trying to do, based upon the mark score, you are trying to identify class labels. Here A, B, C, D and F are the class labels, and this is the equivalence class range. So what you have done, now we have a data set where we have D and C. C is nothing but set of class labels. In this example, class labels are A, B, C, D and F, and the equivalence function or equivalent point that you are trying to divide from your subset D is this particular equation. So this is what you are trying to build. So this is your equivalence function. So if mark score is greater than 90, or if mark score is between the range 80 to 90, or if it is between 7 to 80 or less than 50, or whatever conditions you are trying here, this is nothing but this is the function, equivalence function you are deriving in order to relate your mark score with the grade. So now we have D. D is set of mark score, and C is the class label which is used to define your grade. So what you are doing, you are trying to come up with the function, right? this function will relate your marks with your grade. Similarly, one more classification example from image processing is, from the different components you are trying to recognize the character. So this is the example of character recognition and classification of characters based on recognition. So if this particular components, there are 5 components used here, based upon this 5 components, if you get a pattern like this, then you are saying this is letter A. Similarly, this is letter C, letter E, B, D, and F. So based upon this, what you are trying to do in this example, you are trying to recognize the character based upon how these 5 components are constructed. So this is one of the application where you are trying to classify characters. So next is classification techniques. The commonly used approach is, you will create a specific model by evaluating only your training data. That is, this training data can be known by domain experts. So domain experts will decide for each of the application what should be the ratio of your training set and test set. So once you create a model from your training data, you will apply this model to the new data. So once you apply this model to the new data, you will be able to classify this new data depending upon which class it belongs to. But you have to make sure one thing, that all the classes that you are using in your classification must be predefined. That is, in your data set only you should have a column, say classes, which is predefined, in order to determine to which class your new data belong to. So there are so many common techniques in order to do this. One of the statistical technique that you have is your decision tree. You can either use your decision tree, neural network, or any of the statistical method. So in this chapter, we will be discussing about decision tree as well as Bayesian classifier. Neural network is not part of your syllabus. We will just see how it can be used in neural network, but the problems or the other stuffs are not there in your neural network. So in detail, we have decision tree and Bayesian network. But even your neural nets can be used for classification purpose. So there are different classification techniques. So if a question is asked on classification technique, we will be using 2 techniques, that is decision tree and Bayesian classifier. So classification is a 2-step process where you will construct the model, and in the second phase, you will use the model. So in the phase of construction, what we will do is, we already have a set of predetermined classes. Usually this predetermined classes will be the last column of your data set. That is how your CSV file or your data set will be built. So based upon this predetermined classes, each tuple or sample will belong to this particular class, and this class is termed as class label attribute. From now on, your class to which your attribute belong can be termed as class label. Fine. So it can be your class label, and all the set of tuples used to construct your model is called as your training set. Then once you have the training set class label, you will try to establish a function between your training set and the class label and represent it in a term of a model. So this model can be anything. It can be just the classification rule like we did for your grading example, or your model can be your decision tree, or it can be any kind of classifier that you are learning. It can be your neural net, it can be your k nearest neighbor or Bayesian, or it can also be a mathematical formula which will try to derive the relationship of attribute with the class. So this is the phase of model construction. Once you have constructed a model, then you can go ahead and use the model in order to classify the unknown object or the tuples that you have kept in your test data set. So once the model is done, you can use the test data set and try to classify the tuples or attribute which are there in your test data set. So in test data set, you will not be having your class label. It is basically the unknown object or unknown tuple. So based upon that, you will try to derive to which particular class label your tuple belongs to. So what we are trying to do in your second part, that is your model usage, you are trying to test three things. That is, accuracy of the data or accuracy of the model is predicted, followed by what is your test data set, whether you are able to predict the model correctly or whether it is resulting in overfitting or underfitting of the data. So we'll go step by step. So now we have already assumed that you have constructed the model. Now you want to use the model. So you will take one tuple from your test set, and this test sample should be compared with the result that you have got from the model. So based upon this comparison, what you can get is, you can get accuracy. Accuracy is nothing but it is the percentage or number of test samples that are correctly classified from your model. So for example, I have say 10 test samples. So out of this 10 test samples, if you assume that only 8 tuples or 8 samples are classified correctly, so what will be your accuracy? It will be roughly around say 80%. So you can say the model is 80% accurate, because out of 10 tuples or 10 labels, you are able to classify only 8 tuples correctly, whereas 2 of the tuples or data in your test set are misclassified. What do you mean by misclassification? Actually, it has to belong to say class A, but your model has classified it to say class B or class C. Then that condition is called as misclassification. That is, the error in classification is called as misclassification. So accuracy of the model is used, or it determines how well your model can classify the data. So accuracy can be termed as the percentage of test samples that are classified correctly by the model can be termed as accuracy. Usually your accuracy will be in terms of percentage. Check whether you have followed. So we discussed what is classification, example of classification, what is training set, test set, model, and how we can determine a relationship between the attributes. That is, it can be in terms of any of the classification technique, or through a mathematical formula, or it can also be through neural nets. So let's continue. So as I said, there are two types of grouping. So given a data set, you can group them into two types. One is said to be classification and another is clustering. So broadly, if you have a data set, it can be grouped into classification or clustering. So you say a particular grouping is classification if you have labels associated with the class. That is, it is if you have a training data or observation with label for each of the sample to indicate which class it belongs to, then it is called as supervision or supervised learning technique. In supervised learning, always you have a class label associated with your tuples. So new data is classified as your training set. Usually in your supervised, what you can know is there are two learning methods, supervised and unsupervised. In supervised learning is also called as classification. You can go ahead with classification if and only if you know what are the class label associated with the data set. If you don't know the class labels, then you cannot apply classification. In that case, you can group the tuples based upon technique called clustering or unsupervised learning. In your unsupervised learning, the class labels of your training data is not known to the user. So here, for example, if it is a set of measurement or observation where you are trying to form clusters out of it, you don't know actually to which group it belongs to, but based upon your similarity measures that you have already heard in the last class, using your similarity and dissimilarity metrics, it can be your distance metrics like Euclidean or your Jaccard distance. Usually based upon your distance measure, you will see how attributes are closer or nearer to each other. So based on your Euclidean distance or say your Jaccard distance, you can try to group the attributes based upon its distance. So this method is called as clustering. So here, using one of the measurement technique, that is based upon its similarity or dissimilarity metric, you can try to group the attributes. Here you will not be having any class label. Only based upon your similarity dissimilarity metrics, you will try to find a group. Here the group is called as clusters. So your data set can be divided into n clusters. The only difference between your cluster and classification is, in classification you have a well-defined label or a class label associated with each of the tuple. Whereas in clustering, you have only data sets where you don't have a class label associated with it. So grouping, which is based upon your class label, is called as classification. Grouping of your data points or your data set or your tuple without knowing your class labels, but using your similarity metrics, is called as your unsupervised learning. I hope you are able to follow. So there are two types of learning techniques, supervised learning and unsupervised learning, and classification. The chapter that we are dealing is supervised learning. So what do you mean by supervised learning? For each of the data set that you are considering, you will be having a class label associated with it. Fine. So this is your supervised learning technique. So next question is, for what all we can apply classification? So I hope you have understood the types of attribute. Your attribute can be discrete or continuous. It can be nominal, ordinal, ratio, and interval. So these are the different types of attribute. So classification can be applied for discrete or nominal class label. What do you mean by discrete? It is not a continuous. So you can say either yes, no, true, false. It cannot be like, okay, 90. See, in the example we have taken ranges greater than 90, less than 80 or 90, but we are not taking it as say 80.1 or 80.2, 80.3. Basically, your attribute is discrete. That is, you cannot divide that into smaller subunits, whereas in continuous it can be in terms of your decimal places. So whenever your class labels are discrete in nature, so what do you mean by discrete? So it cannot be further divided into smaller units. So it has to be discrete and it has to be nominal. So what is nominal? Yeah, you can use chart. So tell what is discrete attribute and what is nominal attribute. Definition of discrete and nominal. What do you mean by discrete? Nominal is distinctness, ma'am. Discrete is not continuous. Yeah, discrete is not continuous. So what do you mean by discrete is you can not further divide it into smaller units. So that is the smallest part. To say in a general term, nominal is, what do you mean by nominal? Yeah, Yuvraj, it is correct. It's a quantitative attribute. Nominal as finite number of values. Yeah, hope. Okay. You have understood what is discrete and nominal. So based upon your data set, if your class labels are discrete and nominal, you can go ahead and apply classification to those type of data sets. So what you are trying to do here is you are classifying your data. How you can classify? You are constructing a model using your training set and your class labels, and once the model is done, you are doing a numeric prediction. So it is whenever your value is discrete, that is, it is a binary attribute, you can say it is discrete and nominal. So in this case, you can predict categorical class label. So to which category that particular tuple or sample belongs to is said to be your categorical class value. Numeric prediction can be used. So it can, if you want to use the classification technique for a continuous valued functions, it can also be used for numeric predictions. Like you have other technique like regression. Have you heard about regression? So regression is one of the classification technique. In decision tree, you have different types. So you have ID3 and your Gini index, and one more is gain ratio. So in that, your Gini index can be used for continuous attribute. We will see each one of them in detail. So what you have to know is your classification. That is, if you want to classify your data set based upon your binary attribute, the nature of your data set should be, it should be discrete or nominal. Yeah, we'll continue. So this is what I was speaking about. So this is the illustration of classification. For example, assume that you have a data set with 15 tuples. So in this case, what we will do is we will divide 10 of them into training set and 5 of them into test set. See, in your test set, your class label is empty. This is an unknown data. So from the known, you are trying to find the class label of your unknown data set. So what you are doing, using your training example where you have say three attributes, attribute 1, attribute 2, attribute 3, and you also have a class label associated to it. Here class label is binary attributed, right? You have only two values. Why it is called as binary attribute? You have yes, no, right? Based upon these two attributes or your class label, what you are trying to do is you are learning this model. Once you induce to learn this model, once the model is learned using any of the learning algorithm, so your learning algorithm can be decision tree or your Bayesian classifier in this example. So what you are trying to do is from this example, you are trying to evolve a model by applying a learning algorithm. Once you apply learning algorithm for this training set, you'll be able to come up with a model. So now this model should be applied to your test set. So see, here we have a test set with 5 entries or 5 tuples, where using this attribute, that is say no, small and 55k, you are trying to derive its class. So once you know the model which is learned, now I will apply the test data set or the test set where you are deducing to which class this particular entry belongs to. Similarly, for each of the tuples, you are trying to determine its class to which it belongs to based upon the model that you have derived from your training set. So this model can be got by applying one of the learning algorithm. So in this chapter, you will be dealing with different learning algorithms, how to apply this algorithm for the data set and how to build a model. Once you have built a model, you will apply it to the unknown or the tuples which are not part of your training set. In this case, based upon your learning, you are trying to classify this particular tuples to which class it belongs to. Whether this particular sample belongs to say class S or class no, or this is S or no, this is S or no, this is S or no, this is S or no. So based upon each of the tuple, you are trying to classify whether your attribute is no, attribute is small, attribute is say 55k to which class it belongs to, whether it belongs to class S or class no in our example. So this is the simple example of illustrating your classification task, where the process whatever we have learned is illustrated. So here you have a data set which is divided into training set and test set. Using your training set, you are trying to come up with a model or learn model by inducing one of the learning algorithm. Once I use any of the learning algorithm and my model is devised or you have got the model, what you will do is you will go ahead and apply the model for the test set. In test set, it is a part of your data set where you don't have the class labels. So based upon the findings or the correlation you have got from your training set, you will try to classify each of the tuples into one of the class label. Yeah, Sneha, it will be usually 7:3. That is 70% of your data set will be used for training and 30% will be used for testing. So that is the usual thumb rule, but you can change it according to your need. For example, if you want more data set for training, you can do, or it can be usually 50-50, but the accuracy of the model will be high if you have more samples in your training set. So the ideal case that they have found out is 70-30. So again, what are we doing after we are using a classification, algorithm, constructing the model, and then deriving the set of rules for that particular model, evaluating the test data set, how it will be useful to us? usually your model usage is used to make some decision. It is used in decision making. So based upon the accuracy, you can decide upon, okay, how this data can behave in future. So in order to say, or in order to state it simple, in a simple term, usually the model that you have learned, once you have the model and your evaluation strategy or your test set, based upon the test set, what you can do is you can find out its accuracy. Once you know the accuracy of the data, for example, say you have got the accuracy of say 80% or 85%, where did we lose the 15%? So this can be traced back and you can make some changes in order to improve your accuracy. So this process is called as either overfitting or underfitting. So in this case, there are two categories, overfitting and underfitting. So what is the reason for what you have lost your accuracy? So if you get accuracy of say only 85%, it means that 15% of time misclassification has occurred. So in order to reduce the misclassification, what you can do is you can do some modification in your data set. So this modification can be either underfit or overfit. Don't worry much about that. Once we take up with an example, we will easily come to know what you mean by overfitting. So what you should know is, once your model is ready, you have applied the test set and you have got the result, you have found out the accuracy of the model, what you are trying to do is whether this model that you have learned or experimented is acceptable or not is what you will decide. So what is the takeaway from classification is, if the accuracy of the model is acceptable, then what you will do is you will use this model to further predict or classify your new samples, that is unknown. If you find that the accuracy of model is very less, then you have to go ahead and improve the accuracy by getting more samples into your data set. The accuracy of your model will improve when the amount of data set you are using is more. So in this slide, what you have to know is, once the model is done and you are using it for decision making, you have to figure out whether the accuracy obtained is acceptable for predicting new classes or predicting the unknown tuple of the classes. So I said we will find out accuracy and all, right? Some basic measures in order to find out accuracy is your confusion matrix. So this is your confusion matrix. It is a matrix consisting of the predicted class and true class. Okay, so true classes, actually what is the correct classification? Year 1 represent the correct value or is, or minus 1 is false. This can also be treated as true and false. This is the actual class. Predicted classes, what your model has predicted. So here also you have two attributes, true, false, or yes or no. So this confusion matrix, I said accuracy of the model is obtained. How it is obtained? Usually accuracy of module is obtained by your confusion matrix. So I will explain what is a confusion matrix. So for example, we are considering what type of attribute. It is a binary attribute, means it has two class labels. So say it has two class label, true, false, or yes or no. Similarly, this is the actual class label. Whereas in your predicted class also, what you are trying to predict? You are trying to predict whether it belongs to S class or no class, or it can be true class or false class. So here you have four terms: true positive, false negative, false positive, and true negative. So assume that the actual class or the actual class label that you are trying to test should be positive. You know as human, okay, if this and this are the case. For example, if attribute 1 is yes and attribute 2 is say some value, attribute 3 is the 55 care. If that is the case, my value should be S. As humans, I know what is the true class. But for the true class, if you are expecting the answer should be true, but your predicted class has also got the value as true. In this case, it is said to be true positive. So true positive is a case where your expected class, that is your true class as well as your predicted class is same. Then you call it as true positive. The actual expectation was false. But if you have predicted it as true, then it is called as false negative. Similarly, if the actual class it has to group is true, but you have misclassified it as false, it is called as false positive. Actually, the answer is expected to true from the human evaluation, but from the model evaluation, if you have got it as no or false, it is called as false positive. Similarly, if the predicted answer is false and predicted is false and the actual class is also false, it is called as true negative. See, usually your true positive and your true negative is the amount of accuracy that you have got correctly, that is the amount of labels which are classified correctly is got by true positive and true negative. This is because the amount of truthness, that is the actual class is also 1, the predicted classes is also 1. So there is no error, right? So this is your true positive. Similarly, if the actual class is negative and your predicted is also negative, it is called as true negative. This 2 will account to accuracy of the model. But your false negative and false positive will give the error rate. How many of them have not been classified correctly? Here, the expected class was false, but your model has predicted it as true. Similarly, here, the expected class was true, but your model has misclassified it as false. So this 2, false positive and false negative, is used to determine the error rate, whereas your true positive and true negative is used to find out accuracy, because this will give how much of your tuples have classified correctly, right? So this many of them were positive. Okay, it is correctly predicted as positive from the model. These are expected to be negative. Even your model has predicted it as negative. So these 2 factors are used to find out accuracy. This 2 is used to find out the error in the model. That is the amount of misclassification can be got through false positive and false negative. The amount of classification which are done correctly or the accuracy of the model can be got by true positive and true negative. Okay, so these are the basic performance. So what all we discussed? We discussed these 4 things, that is your training set, test set, evaluation and accuracy. So see, here I have given one diagram. This is the predicted, this is the actual. If the number of prediction is whatever as you expected, that is your expected label was true, and if you have gotten true also from your model prediction, then it is called as true positive. If your expected was false and your predicted answer is also false, then it is false positive. If your expected answer is false, but if you have got it as true from your model, then it is false negative. If your expected answer was true, but if you have got false, it is, what it is? It is true negative. So based upon these 4 factors, you can evaluate model. Each of this is called as hypothesis. Hypothesis is nothing but it is the assumption that you made or assumption that is made in order to infer the results. So how can you infer the results? What you are trying to do is, once you are classified, you are trying to check whether whatever the answer of model got, that is your prediction, is correct as the actual factor or not. That is what is your evaluation. Whereas accuracy is nothing but the percentage of correctly sampled tuples from your example will give you the accuracy. So these are the four evaluation terms that you'll be using in your classification system. That is your training set, test set, evaluation, and accuracy. Yeah, see here one example I have taken. For example, you have name, rank, years, and tenured. Here, tenured is your class label. So it is a binary value. Yes, no, yes, no, yes, no. Right? This is your class label. Whereas these are your attributes. Your name, rank, and years are your attributes. So this is your training set or your training data. Here, along with the data, you also have a class label. So this training data is used and a classification. Using one of the classification algorithm, you will come up with a training model or a classifier. It is also called as classifier. So now using this particular data, you have come up with a classifier. Now, if I say, if, one second. See here, yeah. So this is your training data set where you have certain tuples. So based upon this training set, you will apply one of the classification algorithm and you will get a model or a classifier. Now your classifier is ready. Now if I want to check the tenure data, I will use one of the tuple from your test data set. That is, if rank is equal to professor or year is greater than 6. So what it has to do is it has to check rank of that particular person is, say, professor. And if the number of year is greater than 6, from the model it is got as tenured is equal to yes. So is this correct? Yeah. So in this case, this is correct. So this particular rule that you have got in order to test is called as the rule classifier. From using this rule, what you are trying to do is you are trying to determine its class. Actually, the class was not there. So from your test data set, you have taken one tuple, and from your learning, what you are doing is you are trying to assign a class label. Yes, in this case, it is correct. So whatever you are trying to find is correct. So this is true positive because the expected answer was yes, and even you have got yes from the classifier or the model. Same thing. So what you are trying to do for your classifier or the model, you are training using your trained data. So from the test data, if you take one of the value and this is your data that you are using for your training data. Sorry, this has to be training data, not test data. From your training data, you are identifying a classifier. From the classifier, with the unseen data, you are trying to classify this. For this particular example, the answer turns out to be yes, so which is correct in our case. So for this particular model, accuracy is true, but this cannot be done, or accuracy cannot be obtained by only a single tuple. So even here you have to use many tuples in order to find out the accuracy of the model. For a example, this is a toy example where you have taken only one tuple from the unseen data and you are trying to classify. I hope you understand. In reality, actually, your data set will be in terms of many kilo lines. That is, it will be around 60,000 or 80,000 of lines will be there. But in order to understand the model, we have used a toy example where you have only 4 data and a single thing. Here, even humans can identify this. but you will go and you will achieve the power of your machine learning algorithms or your data mining algorithms, your supervised learning, whenever there are huge amount of data in your data set. Is this understood? Any doubts? I hope you are able to understand what is classification. If you have any doubts, you can go ahead and ask. Before moving to decision tree, I want you to know whether you have understood classification and what is your training set, test set, what is model, followed by how you can predict. Any doubts?